be about communication link analysis and budget analysis for the design of digital communication link. As we mentioned last week, that we are prepared now to start design digital communication link in terms of quantifying the required budget in terms of power, bandwidth, antenna gain, and so on. However, before we start studying how to do that, we need to go through some important aspects about wireless channels. So in channels, we have several kinds of limitations, as we mentioned before, like channel fading, we have channel losses, propagation losses, we have inter-symbol interference, we have also additive noise, which can be seen in every receiver, like thermal noise and chat noise. Part of this lecture has been already covered in telecommunication electronics course. You studied also noise there. How many of you attended that telecommunication electronics? Okay, so most of you that have already. But again, we will go through the same concepts again in the lecture as well. And we know that we have different modulation techniques, as we studied before, like we have binary phase shift keying, we have FSK, we have quadrature phase shift keying, we have EQAM, we have ASK. So we have different kinds of modulation techniques and also modulation levels. And we mentioned also that the selection of the proper modulation method depends on the required quality of service in terms of data rate, in terms of bit error rate, and so on. So the channel we have, I will just go through them very fast. Some limitations of the channel: that we have the problem of inter-symbol interference, we have seen this before. Local oscillator phase noise, we also mentioned this in the previous lectures when we talk about when the local oscillator is not coherently synchronized with the carrier frequency, either in phase or in frequency, then we have errors in the reception. AM-BM conversion and AM-to-BM conversion. Also, when we have nonlinearities in the power amplifier, these nonlinearities can cause some phase fluctuations because of the nonlinearities in the amplitude of the cosine wave. We have limiter loss or enhancement. Usually when we have phase shift keying, for example, our information is in the phase, not in the amplitude. So that we have, for example, A cosine omega 0 t plus phi I, the information is in phase. So because of the of noise, then the received signal will be like this transmitted plus noise. And this noise, it has two impacts. One impact in phase, and it has also impact on amplitude. But we don't have information amplitude, because our information is all in phase. So the phase will be corrupted by noise, but also the amplitude. So we want to remove these changes in amplitude because of noise, because there is no information amplitude. Then we can use limiter. The limiter is either limiter, something like this. So if the signal is above zero, it becomes like one. Less than zero, it becomes like minus one. So we will have square wave with the same phase and the frequency like omega, like this phi. So this we preserve the information, but we remove the fluctuations in the amplitude. However, this limiter, it has also problem, because we don't have either limiter like this one. So the limiter will be something like that. Okay. So in that case, if the signal is very weak, okay, it can be eliminated. Okay, it can be like zero; it will not be out, or it can be also reverted, because if the signal is very weak, or we might have also enhancement in the noise. So the noise here, if the noise is, if the signal should be negative, but because of the noise it comes to the positive, then it will be amplified. So this is also one of the problems of the limiters. Multiple carrier intermodulation. For example, at the base station, we might use like different frequencies. Different frequencies. For example, if we have cosine omega zero, we take 2 by f zero t. This is for one information. Let's say this is the signal S1, okay? And of course, it might have also like phase information. And then we have this two, a cosine 2 by f1 t plus 5, for example. Then we have two different frequencies that it would, should be transmitted in the downlink to two different receivers. Okay, so we have different frequencies. If the amplifier is perfectly linear, of course the output will be just amplification for this one and this one. So the output will be just summation for those two frequencies. But if there is nonlinearity in the amplifier, and usually these they are nonlinearities, then the output, the transmitted signal, for example, R of T, it will be like the gain J1 S1 plus gain J if it is the same gain, we can say also J1 S2, but it will be some also component which is related to, we can say that it is like S1 plus S2 squared. It can be like multiplied by alpha, of course. This alpha should be zero, actually, in ideal power amplifiers, but it is not zero. So we would have some component which gives some linearity, because the power amplifier, if it is perfectly linear, it means that it would be the least efficiency. To increase the efficiency of the amplifiers, we sometimes lose some linearity. So we have some linearity to increase the efficiency. What we mean by efficiency is the relation between the power generated to the power consumed in the amplifier. So, for example, a class A amplifier, which has the highest linear properties, the efficiency can be only 25%. What it means? It means that if the amplifier consuming 4 watts, only 1 watt will be in the output. The others are consumed, which is not efficient. Okay, so increasing the efficiency, we lose linearity. So this can be generated because of the nonlinearities in the power amplifier at, for example, base station. Okay, when we have S1 plus S2 squared, what it means? It means that A cosine, I will ignore the phase, so we say that just 2 pi F0t plus, okay, that's also A is 1, cosine 2 pi F1 T squared. This would be, the output would be cosine squared 2 by F0 T plus cosine squared 2 by F1 T plus 2 cosine 2 by F1 T cosine 2 by F0 T or F2. Okay, this is 0 again. Okay? When you have cosine squared, okay, this is related to the frequency when you make this trigonometric exchange or conversion. This, the frequency component here is 2f0. Okay, if you remember that, when we say that cosine A plus B equal to cosine A cosine B minus sine A sine B. Okay, so that if you have A and B the same, so cosine 2A, okay, and you know that, for example, if you say that cosine A minus B equal to what? Cosine A cosine B plus sine A times sine B. Okay, so if you add those together, what you get? You get cosine A times cosine B equal to half of cosine A plus B, okay, plus cosine A minus B. Now, if A equal to B, what we have here? We have cosine squared A equal to what? Half. This would be cosine 2A, and A minus B equal to 0, so cosine 0 equal to 1, plus 1. means that this cosine squared is 2a, 2 times 2 by f0 t. It can be like 2 by 2 f0 t. This 2. So now the frequency component is 2 f0. This frequency component again is 2 f1. This frequency component, now f0 times f1, it is the same. So it would be plus and minus. So we have the frequency component f0 plus f1, and we have frequency, another frequency component f1 minus f0. Okay, what happened now? Because of this nonlinearity in the power amplifier, we generate four different frequencies, another frequencies. We generate 2f0, 2f1, and f0 plus f1, and f1 minus f0. For example, if f1 equal to, let's say, 1.5 gigahertz, and f0 equal to 1 gigahertz, for example, just example, okay, what frequency component will be generated from this nonlinearity? That we have 2f0, we will generate 2 gigahertz. We will have 3 gigahertz. We will have here 2.5 gigahertz. And here we will have 0.5 gigahertz. You can think now, if you there are another frequencies, for example, another signal, F2, for example, sent at 2 gigahertz, then you will generate some interference with that other frequencies. Because now we have other frequencies which can make interference with the other signals. Different frequencies that are not generated already inside the, or we don't want them. They are not desirable frequencies, but they will be generated because of this nonlinearity properties of the power amplifier. Okay? Antenna efficiency, there is no efficient antenna 100%. Means that the power to the antenna will not be propagated directly. So we have antenna efficiency can be 50%, can be 40%. And sometimes we need also to have like perfect matching between that the transmission line and the antenna, as we will study them in different course. In RF technology course, we study such kind of things. We have atmospheric losses and noise. You can see in this figure, this is the losses due to H2O at different distance from air. So at 0 kilometer, for example, you can see that at 20 gigahertz, we have some results here where the losses can be high, and also you can see at 60 gigahertz we have very high losses due to the absorption of the wave because of O2 here. And also we have another resonance at about 120 gigahertz. So we have different resonance absorption, high absorption rate of the electromagnetic wave. Space losses, as we will study today, also causes that high attenuation or the power losses in the transmission of the signal in the wireless case. Adjacent channel interference, the interference between adjacent channels it might interfere to each other because it is not possible to have perfect frequency separation between channels. For example, sometimes for simplicity we say that we have, this is one channel, channel one, and here we have, for example, channel two. It is not possible actually to have sharp ending channels at certain frequency, because in that case, if it is sharply ended, it means that in time it is unlimited. But it is limited in time, so it cannot be in this way. So practically, every channel it has some bands, more than it is required band, and also channel two. So they always we have some interference between adjacent channels. Of course, we can minimize those interference by keeping some protection distance between different channels in the frequency domain. Core channel interference, we cannot assign certain band for every user. Usually we have to reuse bands because bands are limited. Like in JSM, for example, we have in the standard JSM, we have 25 megahertz, and it is used now in the world by billions of people. So we cannot assign band for every user. So we have to reuse bands. And using bands, we have like code channel interference between users. Galactic or cosmic noise, star noise, terrestrial noise, so all of them, they generate different kind of electromagnetic wave radiating energy, which makes interference to wireless communication. Receiver noise is the major noise generated by, for example, Feldman noise, as we studied them today. We have also shot noise in the semiconductors. So we have several kinds of noises added together, and this limits the performance in wireless communication. Imperfect synchronization reference, this is studied before. Time varying channels and Doppler effect. The channel is not fixed, the channel is time varying. It means that if you estimate the channel now, you cannot rely on that estimation after a few seconds, for example, because the channel can change. So every time we need to estimate the channel. So this is one other problem in wireless communication. Okay, this example that as I now I did on the whiteboard about the linearity impact. Okay, now the receiver signal in free space. We will start with the free space case. In free space, if you have like anisotropic antenna, there is no isotropic antenna in black spot. If we assume that we have isotropic antennas, means that it propagates the energy equally likely in every dimension. Okay, so we assume that we have this isotropic antenna, and we feed this antenna with power P. And we assume now that this antenna is ideal, so the all power will be propagated. Okay, now. If we come after distance r from this or after distance d, for this antenna, because now we are in 3D, okay? So after distance d, we will have like ball, okay? Ball with distance, with the radius d. What is the area of that ball, the surface area? It will be 4 by d squared. This is the area of the ball with radius d. Okay, now we have this power p. Okay, now as I said, we assume that it is ideal. We think here it is ideal. Actually in RF technology course, we study more details about electromagnetic propagation about this case. It is not that easy as well. Now we explain it, but let us take the ideal case. So the power intensity, okay, the power density over that surface, it will be simply b divided by 4 by d squared watt per meter squared. We just divide the power, okay, over the area, because this power b will go equally likely in all directions. So now over that ball, if you make a closed integration, okay, of the whole power coming from that after distance d over the surface, then you will get also, again, you will get b, because b will come out like perpendicular about from all the surfaces are equally likely of that ball. So it means that the power density will be b, the transmitting power, if we call this bt, for example, bt divided by 4 by d squared. This gives watt per meter squared, watt per meter squared. Okay, now if you put some antenna on that surface and you want to pick up some signals, some power from that signal. Okay. In that case, the received power will be that power density Vt divided by 4 by d squared multiplied by the effective aperture or the effective area of that antenna, because now we have the unit of this antenna is meter squared. This is the effective area, not the physical area, but this is the effective area of the antenna is AAR, we call it, and multiplied by the power density. Here the unit of the power density is watt per meter squared, the area here is meter squared, so the output will be in watts. So this is the received power. Okay, from this definition, we can also define the effective area. The effective aperture of the antenna is the power received divided by the power density. Okay, so we define it in this way. This will be the power received of from the antenna. Okay, now if the antenna has some gain, some power gain. Okay, so the power gain is defined as the maximum power which can be seen in the maximum direction or the certain direction. For example, if we use some antenna which real antenna which has directivity, certain directivity. Now the power will not be distributed in the same way as before. It will not be equally light, but the power can be distributed with certain radiation pattern. For example, so that it can be like this way, then we have some powers in other directions as well. Okay, so now we have some radiation pattern. The power is not equally likely in every dimension, but it will be concentrated in certain direction, and in that direction where we have the maximum gain, this is called the directivity or the antenna gain. Because there's a difference between antenna gain and antenna directivity related to whether we look to it from the input power or from the propagated power. Okay, because in the input power, there's some power will be consumed inside the antenna before it is propagated. But anyway, we will not talk about this. Now, I will give you some, of course, there's some definition about the gain of the antenna, as you can see it on the slide, but I will make it more clear for you in this way. Assume that you have okay, as input power, you bought certain power, PT, and with this directive antenna, okay, and then you measured the power density at certain distance d, for example, at certain distance d. At this distance, you measured here the power density because of this input power, for example, Vt1. Let's say we call it Vt1. So you feed the antenna with power Vt1, okay, and then you measured at same distance. You measure the power density in the direction of the maximum radiation pattern. So you measure the power density, certain power density at that distance. Okay. Now you remove this antenna which has certain directivity or certain gain, and you put isotropic antenna. Now when you put isotropic antenna, if you feed the isotropic antenna with the same power, do you expect the power density here will be more or less?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I will repeat. Now you have antenna with directivity, with gain, which has gain, okay? And you feed this antenna with power BT1. You came to the maximum directivity, and you measure the power density or the received power at certain distance from the antenna. Okay, for example here, we measure it and we find that it is BT1. Let's say 1 micro watt per meter squared, for example. Then we remove this antenna which has directivity, which has gain, and we put isotropic antenna. Isotropic antenna will radiate the power, the same power, but in all directions equally likely. And we put the same power BT1. Do you expect that this power BT2, that due to the antenna, to the isotropic antenna, do you think that it will be more or less than BT1?
To be less, yes.
Why? Because now the power distributed everywhere, not in certain
direction.
Okay. But if you want to have the same BT1, then you need to increase the power of BT2. Now, you increase the power for the isotopic, you increase until you get the same power density. This BT2 divided by BT1 is the antenna gain. Okay? For example, if in the beginning, the first you put the power equal to 1 watt, you measure BD1, you find that what is BD1 according to 1 watt. Then, to have the same BD1 with isotopic antenna, you use 1,000 watts. Then the antenna gain equal to 1,000. The antenna gain equal to 1,000. It is very similar to the lighting. You know this torch, for example, or for the candle, when you use directivity, you can go to very far distance than with the same power, without reflector. Okay, so this is the antenna gain. Of course, here it is given the slight mathematical definition, but it is the same as the physical interpretation here. And this effective aperture or effective area of the antenna, okay, usually is related to the physical area for some antennas, not for all antennas. For example, in parabolic form of antenna, there is a relation between the effective aperture and the physical area. Okay, and this relation is given by that the effective aperture is just linear relation, is some efficiency times the physical area of the parabolic antenna. You know the parabolic antenna, so you measure the area of the dish, and then it is related to the effective aperture. Okay, some other antennas, like dipole antenna, no, it is not related to the physical area. But for some antennas, they are related. Okay. Now, since we have gain for the antenna, and we can say that the received power now equal to what? Not only transmitted power, but we should multiply the transmitted power by the gain of the antenna. Because now the antenna has gain. Okay? And okay, divided by 4 by d, the distance d squared, and then multiplied by the effective aperture or the effective area of the antenna. Actually, there is a relation also for almost all antennas between the effective aperture and the gain of the antenna. And this relation is given by like the antenna gain is equal to 4 by, okay, times the effective aperture of the antenna divided by lambda squared. Okay, this is the relation between the antenna gain and the effective aperture. There is always the relation between that. As you increase the effective aperture, as higher antenna gain you will have. But it is also related to the carrier frequency that you use. Lambda is the wavelength, and you know that wavelength equal to what? The speed of light, speed of a wave, divided by this frequency. Now, we can substitute, based on this equation, the effective aperture is equal to lambda squared times the antenna gain divided by 4 by. We can substitute this in the relation here. So the received power equal to the transmitted power times transmitting antenna gain times receiver antenna gain times lambda squared divided by, we have here 4 by and we have here 4 by, so it becomes 4 by d all squared. Okay, we can take this lambda inside here, so it becomes the power received, the received power equal to the transmitted power times the transmitting antenna gain, receiver antenna gain divided by 4 by d divided by lambda all squared. They are the same. So here we call this factor, we call it the channel losses, N. So the received power equal to the transmitting power times the transmission antenna gain times the receiver antenna gain divided by channel losses. This is free space channel losses. The free space channels. You can see here, we assume that we don't have buildings, we don't have reflection, we don't have refraction, we have nothing. We have just direct the signal comes from point to point, okay? And this, in this case, it is called the free space channel model. free space generally. This can be very good approximation if you, for example, for the intercommunication between satellite, inter-satellite communication in the space when they communicate to each other, this model is very, very accurate. But on Earth is not. On Earth is not, because we have many other factors, like we have like a multipath. The signal can be reflected from Earth, reflected from other places. So we have diffraction, we have refraction, we have absorption, we have many other things in reality. In macrocell, orbitocell, yes. But between satellites above, it is very good.
How about satellite?
Yes, it is also good, very good approximation for the CPT. Okay. Usually, in the channel calculations on the losses calculations, usually engineers likes to work with decibel. Okay. So now in this slide, it is just the conversion of the power from watt to B in dB. So you can see that the received power, you take just 10 log of the power that received, and then we have, as you can see in the slide, so we have here 10 log BT GT. JR divided by 4 pi d divided by lambda all square, and then the multiplication of log becomes summation, and the division becomes subtraction. Okay, you know this, that when we have log, for example, a times b is equal to log a plus log b, and when we have log a divided by b is equal to log a minus log b. When you have log a to the power of n, this is equal to n log a. So with these basic relations, we can just follow the same here in the equation. So we have here the power transmitted, but now in dB. And the gain, channel gain in dB, antenna gain, transmitter antenna gain in dB, receiver antenna gain in dB, and minus, we have 2 here, so 2 comes to 10, becomes minus 20, then we have log 2 by d divided by lambda, and we can continue actually making this, expanding this relation. Okay.
Same question.
Yes, please.
Like in two way ground, mm-hmm. you have the effects of
Yes, we are coming to it now.
Because I was getting confused.
Yes, now we are coming to this, exactly to this point. But the receiver signal power in macro cell, when we have macro cell or micro cell, then we have this, as you mentioned now, we have this like incident wave and reflected wave, exactly as you said. In that case, the relation between the receiving power and transmitting power, it can be more accurately to be represented in this equation. Actually, when they made some measurements about the receiving signal power and the transmitting signal power, because you know the transmitting signal and you can measure the receiving signal, and you know the antenna gains that you use, then you can easily build some model of the wireless channel. And actually found that the relation is not varying with the distance square, but with the distance of the power form. Okay, so if we take the previous equation that we did, the received power, we said that it is transmitting power times transmitter antenna gain, receiver antenna gain, then divided by the channel losses. Okay, if you look to this, this is equal to like power transmitting gain R by 4 by and divided by lambda C squared, and here we have the distance C squared. Okay? In the measurement, you can actually make all this as constant, because you make for sensing carrier frequency, 4 by is constant, the gain of the transmitter, the antenna, you know them, and you can make them all constant. So this can be represented like, let's say, alpha power transmitted divided by d, d squared, okay? This is the power, the receiving power. Now, we make some measurement. We transmit certain power. We know in the transmitter, we put the power, for example, transmitting 1 watt. Then we have a receiver somewhere. We know the distance, and we measure the received bar. Now, if you look to this at in dB scale, so the bar receiver in dB equal to, this is constant as I said, so it will be like in dB, alpha in dB is equal to 10 log alpha plus 10 log bar transmitter plus 20 log the distance d. Okay. When they measure this in practice, they found that this model is bad. This model was not fitting quite well because usually they put like the transmitting in the, this is the distance, for example, the distance, and then with the distance, because they fix also the transmitting power, for example, at certain value. So this is the distance and this is the power received in dB. Okay? And then they take some measurements. They found that this model was bad, was not fitting the received signal very well. So what they did here? Simply they come and instead of putting this 2, they put it like n. Okay? And then they have 10 n times log d. Okay. And with this, they have measurements now. They have measurement points and they have the model. With this model, they are able now to make like curve fitting. In the curve fitting, you measure the distance between the received power and this model, and then you find what is the optimum n which minimizes the error. And they found this n is always close to 4, like 3.7, 3.6, 4.2, 4.8. It is between 3 to 4, it depends on the environment. Depends on the environment, then they have, this is the optimum n. It is not 2 anymore. Okay? And after that, even after this fitting of n, they found still we have error. And this error, they got it as like lambda, and this is the optimum. When you optimize n, everything is optimum, this lambda is normal distribution. Normal distribution with mean zero. Zero mean, and it has some variance like sigma, delta, square. Okay? They found that as normal distribution with zero mean. This is called the model error. The model error. Okay? Of course, it should be zero mean, because if it is not zero mean, you can simply add it to alpha, if it is not zero. But this is zero mean and it is Gaussian. It is Gaussian. Okay, now they found that this n should be, as I said, 4 is good approximation. 4 is good approximation. Now, if you want to bring back from this to the linear case, from dB to linear case, then this would be, okay, this is constant. You can just, because this constant, so you can just ignore it for a while. Then what we have the transmitting power, as we see here, okay, divided by d. Now d becomes, instead of 2, it becomes now
4.
And we have, because when you take back from this to this way, you take 10 of the power. 10 of the power, those values divided by 10. Okay? Yeah. It means that, for example, when you have log for base 10 for any value a, okay, if you take 10 of the power of this value, you will get a. You will get a. So means that you take 10 of the power for every term here. So here we have 10 of the power. What we have? We have this delta divided by 10, because we divide by 10. Well, because we take 10 log. So now we divide by 10. So it is 10 of the power of delta divided by 10. But delta is normal distribution. Delta is normal distribution. 10 of the power of delta, it is called log normal distribution. Named, it is another distribution, it is called log normal. Log normal. It means that when you take the log, it becomes normal. When you take the log for this one, you get normal distribution. But 10 of the power of delta is log normal distribution. And this is very famous representation, as you can see here in the slide. The received power is, this is chi. Chi is log normal distribution times the power transmitting divided by d of the power 4. This is good approximation. It's a good approximation for the macro cell case. Okay. Of course, if you have antenna gain, you can also multiply it by the antenna gain with this transmitting power. Usually, we use what is known as effective isotropic radiation power. Effective isotropic radiation power is simply is the transmitting power times the antenna gain of the transmitter. Okay. So actually, when you look to the standards, for example, when they talk about Bluetooth, in the standard they say that the maximum power that you can use, for example, is 1 watt. I think it is this. I think according to the standard is 100 milliwatt, 0.1 watt. Okay. But what they mean by 0.1 watt, they don't mean BT. They mean BT times the antenna gain. Otherwise, it would be tricky because you can put big dish. And then you can, instead of transmitting 0.1 watt, you might have BT times antenna gain equal to 100 watt. Even the use, the transmitting is 0.1, but if the antenna gain is equal to 1000, 1000 times is 0.1 equal to 100. The isotropic radiation power would be 100 watt in that case. Okay? So usually this is the limited power, the effective isotropic radiation power. This is exactly a question that you came, that when we have, as you can see in the slide, when we have like incident wave, as you can see it here in the slide, and we have antenna gain equal to dt, and also the arm and the receiver, and we have the height of the transmitters ht and hr and the receiver, and the distance is d. So what will be the channel model in that case, that simple case. So actually it is very like close to the measurements, because now you can prove mathematically actually that the relation will be related to d of the power 4, not d of the power squared. Okay, not d squared, but d4, as it is shown here. So the received power will be the antenna gain of the receiver and times the transmitter, times the height of the receiver squared, times the height of the receiver squared, divided by d the power 4, multiplied by the transmitting power. Again, this gives some approximation, but this is in the ideal case. We talk now in the ideal case. So we have only one band. We have only one reflected band. But in reality, we don't have one reflected band. We have many reflected bands, which makes the model more complicated. Actually, there are one branch in electromagnetic and communication about channel modeling. Channel modeling is not that easy. Channel modeling. We have deterministic channel modeling. We have stochastic channel models. We have like empirical channel model. We have ray tracing channel model. We have many kinds of channel models, and they are very important in the radio planning. When you want, for example, to install like LTE or 4G in certain area, you need to have the radio planning. Then you need to have like real time picture of the area to build your model. Thermal noise, as I mentioned, that you have already studied this in electronic communication course, but I just go to it fast. So, according to the major source of noise in electronics is the thermal noise and the shear noise. Okay, and thermal noise is because of the kinetic energy of molecules inside any conductor. So when we have temperature above the zero Kelvin, then those molecules and atoms will move randomly, and then the electrons, because we have free electrons, so the electrons will be also moving across the sectional area of that conductor or resistor or whatever in very random way. It will be completely random. Okay, and when the number of electrons reach to one side is more than the cross reach to the other side, then we have voltage drop. Okay, but because of the electrons are moving completely in a random manner, so the average voltage across any resistor equal to zero. We have any resistor here, so if you measure that, even if we have a lot of electrons, okay, moving in completely random manner, and sometimes the number of electrons here more than here, so we have positive the square root of this one. So the average value is 4. The square root of KTBR. This is the square root of, it's 4 here.
4.
Yes. Then it becomes 2. Okay? And this is ideal. This is ideal resistor. Now, what is the maximum power? What is the maximum power you can see from this resistor? Now, every resistor or every conductor you can think about as a voltage source. Every resistor is a voltage source. I mean, if you take a resistor and you have very, very sensitive oscilloscope and you put it across the resistor, you will really see in the screen something like that. You can, it is very, very random manner, okay, with zero E. Now, what is the maximum power it can be deliverable from that ideal resistor? You know that the maximum power will be achieved when the load Rn is the same as R. Okay, so the same as this is will be the maximum power delivered. Otherwise, if it is short circuit, we will have maximum current, but the power will be maximum current. The voltage is zero. So zero times something is zero. So the power consumed will be zero. If you have open circuit, we have maximum voltage, but the power again zero. The maximum power deliverable from this R to any load will be achieved if the resistance of the load is the same as the resistance of the noise generator. Okay. Now, since they are the same, so the voltage will be divided equally. Here we have 2 square root kT dr. So it means that on this resistor will be square root of kT dr, and here we have square root of kT dr again. Because we have 2 here. So one part here and one part here, because they are equal resistance. This is the voltage divided by the resistor. Okay, now what is the power consumed here? The power consumed, we know that it is the RMS voltage square divided by the resistor. Okay, then this square, square root of KTBR square divided by the resistor R. So it means that this would be KTBR, R cancels R, so we have KTB. This will be the power, the noise power seen by any resistor. So you can see that the maximum power is not depending on the resistance itself. It's not depending on, there's noise R here. Because this is the maximum deliverable power. This is the maximum deliverable power, is KTBR. B is the bandwidth. This noise, by the way, is white noise. Means that we assume that it is equally likely everywhere in the spectrum. T is the temperature of the resistor. You can see that when you for physical resistor, if you increase the temperature, this will be increased linearly. Okay, K is Boltzmann constant, which is constant 1.38 times 10 to the power minus 23 joules. Okay, now this is the KT beam. Now this temperature. What happens if you have circuit, not single resistor? If we have some circuit, some system here, where we have conductors, resistors, transistors, circuits, many things here. Okay? Now we don't talk anymore about physical temperature. Here we mentioned this is a physical temperature in Kelvin, but here we don't talk about physical temperature. If you look to this equation, KTB, B is the bandwidth of your system. Okay? K is constant, it's not changing. What is the part which change represents noise? Is T. T is the parameter which represents the noise. Okay? Higher T, higher noise power. Lower T, lower noise power. Okay. Now we can define what is known as equivalent noise temperature. T E is equal to equivalent noise temperature. It is not the certainty could be the physical temperature, not necessarily physical temperature. It can be in case if you talk about single resistor. But now in general, for certain system, you can see that for this system, if you measure the noise, here, noise power, and you find that the noise power was, let's say, 1 microwatt. This is the average noise power. You measure the average noise power, it was 1 microwatt. Regardless of what's happening inside. Okay? Then we know if the system has bandwidth of 1 megahertz. Okay? Then okay. It is KTB equal to 1 × 10⁻⁶ watts. Okay? Now what is TE? TE equal to 1 times 10 to the power minus 6 divided by B, bandwidth is only 1 to the 10 to the power 6, 1 mega, times K. K is constant, is times 1.23 times 10 to the power 23. Okay? When you solve now for this one, you will get what?
Equivalent
T. T now, it can be like 10 to the power 6, for example. Kelvin. It can be 10 to the power 10. It can be more than the temperature of sun. But is it true? No, it is not the physical temperature. It is the equivalent noise temperature. It is some number represents the noise. Now we need something to represent noise. So we represent noise by this equivalent noise temperature. Clear? If you divide, you remember that when we talk about noise spectral density, we divide the noise power by the bandwidth. So N equal to the noise power spectral density equal to N KTB divided by the bandwidth B. B cancel B, then we have K. So the noise, the equivalent noise temperature, the noise spectral density is constant times the equivalent noise temperature of the system. Okay, constant times the equivalent noise temperature of the system. So for this system, you can calculate what is N0 based on this relation. Okay, this is what we know before that about EB over N0, you have it. Okay, now we take a break for 5 minutes and then we come to continue about the theorem. And also, I'd like to come to at least to solve 2 examples because we have 6 or 7 solved examples in those slides. But I like to solve with you at least 2 examples to show you how to solve problems regarding to this kind about noise and noise figures and so on. Okay, we continue. Is it fun?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Now we talk about noise figure. Noise figure is also one parameter to assess the noise properties or the performance of communication system. So if we have, for example, the part of the system, let's say we have amplifier with gain J, and you have the input, so we have signal input is I, and we have external noise. We have external noise N I. Okay? And then we have the output of this amplifier, we have signal output, and we have noise output. And we know that one of the important performance measure is the signal to noise ratio. So here, the signal to noise ratio at the input of this amplifier, we can put that SI divided by NI, and the signal to noise ratio at the output is SO divided by NI. Okay, what do you expect about the signal to noise ratio in the output of this amplifier? Should it be less or more than or the same as the signal to noise ratio at the input? Higher. So you expect that for the amplifier, the signal to noise ratio should be higher than the signal to noise ratio at the input. Let us see. Let us do that mathematically to see what will be the result.
Should be the same.
Okay, let us see. This is the external noise. This is the external noise, and this is the output noise. Now, what is the output? The output signal. Signal power in the output should be gain times signal at the input. Okay. Now we assume this amplifier has gain, so it amplifies the signal. So the output signal will be J times SI. Okay. What will be the output noise? Would be J times what? Also NI plus the noise of the amplifier itself, because we said that every system now generates noise. Every system generates noise. So, and you know that this noise usually generated outside and it has impact on the outside, on the output. Okay? But we are interested to refer every noise to the input. Why? Because the input is the input where the signals come. So for comparison reason, we need to see that the noise in the input. So if we, for example, there is no input, and there is no noise input, And then you was able to evaluate the noise at the output. You take this noise, you divide it by gain, and bring it to the input. So here we call it like N, for example, for the system, N S input. Okay? Usually every noise in systems, it is referred to the input of the system, not to the output. Because in the input, if I give you that noise at the output, and now you want to compute the signal oscillation, can you compute it? It is difficult. So, but when we refer it, or we refer it to the input, then it is easier. Now we have the noise at the input of the system. If you have a receiver, and you heard about the sensitivity of receivers. Everyone here, that every receiver has sensitivity. The sensitivity of the receiver is the ability, is the smallest signal that it can detect. Okay, it means what? For example, if you have this is the receiver on X, and then from the antenna here, the sensitivity of the receiver actually depends on the noise of that receiver, because the signal, the sensitivity, the smallest signal should be greater than the noise generated by the receiver itself. Otherwise, you won't be able to detect it, because it will be like buried inside the noise. Okay, or under the noise. So here we need that. For example, if this noise input of the receiver, let's say equal to 1 microwatt, for example, or 1 picowatt, for example, then we need the signal to be at least, for example, 10 times or 20 times. If it is 10 times, then we call that this receiver has sensitivity of 10 picowatt. It means that this is the smallest power signal that can be detected. It depends on the noise. So the noise should be referred to input. Every noise should be referred. Now this is the noise of the system, that NSI. In the slide, I name it different, so it is NAI. You understand what I mean. So this is NSI. So here it will be NI plus the noise of the system. Okay? Let us now divide the signal noise ratio of the output equal to J times SI divided by J multiplied by NI plus NSI. Gain comes with the gain. So you can see easily that now it is not SI divided by NI, but SI divided by NI plus NSI, which means that this one will be lower than the signal oscillation at the input. Okay? Then signal to noise ratio at the input divided by the signal to noise ratio at the output usually is greater than or equal to 1, because the signal to noise ratio at the input is greater than the signal to noise ratio at the output for every system. If this amplifier is perfect, means that it will not contribute any extra noise, then it will be the same. It will be 1. This value is called noise figure. Noise figure of the system. Noise figure of the system. And usually it is given in dB. Usually it is given in dB. Okay? Let us now use this F. So F here equal to the signal oscillation at the input, so it is SI divided by NI divided by signal oscillation at the output, so it is SI divided by NI plus NSI. This way. So SI cancels SI. Okay, so the noise figure equal to N of noise NI plus N of the system SI divided by NI, and this would be 1 plus the noise of the system divided by the noise of input. So this is the noise figure for every system. Okay? And this is the noise power. Noise power, we know that it is KT of the system times B divided by KT of the input times B. K would be cancel each other. Then it becomes the noise figure equal to 1 plus TE divided by T of the input. Now, the noise figure for every system depends on the noise equivalent noise temperature of the external noise. But this can be confusing because now we need some parameter to compare between systems. So they agree to have this comparison for certain TI. So if we call it like T0, and this is the room temperature, it is 290 degrees Kelvin. 290 Kelvin is equivalent to about 225 degrees. Okay, so this is constant, so this is about 290 Kelvin. Okay, and now this is the equivalent noise temperature of the system. As we mentioned, this equivalent noise temperature is a measure for noise. Measure for noise. So now we have, you have two exchangeable parameters. Either you represent the system by TE or by noise figure. Or by noise figure. And usually it is given in dB. Usually it is given in dB. But this is, of course, this is linear scale. It's not dB. For example, if this is equal to 3, then you need to convert it to dB. Then you take 10 log of F, which is 3. Then you can compute this to dB. Of course, you can now transfer from one system to other. The line losses, we don't have that much time, so for the line losses, I will not give the derivation, but it is enough to say that if you have a transmission line or connectors between the antenna and the receiver, for example, and usually they are not amplifiers, they are like they reduce the signal. They are lossy, okay? They have lost not amplification. In that case, it can be a proof that this system or any transmission line can be represented as a system with noise figure F equal to the losses N. The losses, the total losses. If, for example, if you have losses equal to 10 dB, for example, connection, which has losses of 10 dB, when you deal with system, you replace it with like the noise impact, like a system which has noise figure equal to the same as the losses. The proof is given in the slides, but we don't have time to go through it. Now, if you have like cascaded system, as you know, every amplifier or every system we have cascaded type, we have amplifiers, we have oscillators, okay? We have, for example, detector. Then every system, communication system, can be represented like we have system 1 connected to system 2 connected to system 3 and so on, okay? Every system now, we have, for example, we assume that we have the bandwidth beam for the system, okay? And this system, it has effective noise temperature of TE1. This one is TE2, TE3, and so on. Then we have the input here. The input can be, of course, comes from antenna or whatever. Okay. Then we have the external noise coming, and then we have the system. Let us study now what is the equivalent or the composite noise temperature of that old system. Okay. As I said, usually we are looking to the at the input of the system, okay? Then, what is the noise power? The total noise power here. The total noise power here, N equal to, it is N, for example, composite, composite, we can call it that, due to the system, equal to the noise of the first system, it is KTE1, miss P, okay, plus the noise of the second system, it is KTE2 times B. This is the noise here, but we want to transfer it here. So we divide by the gain of the first system here, the gain of the second system up to the gain. So this will be divided by J1. Okay? For this one, it will be KTE3 times B divided by J1 times J2. So J1 plus KTE4B by J1, J2, J3, and so on. Now this is the equivalent noise temperature. It is also, can we say that it is KT composite of all system times P. So you can see that. You can cancel P from every term, cancel P from every term. Then simply the composite equivalent noise temperature for the whole system equal to what? TE1 plus TE2 divided by J1 plus TE3 divided by J1 times J2, and so on. This result is very, very important. Why? Because it indicates that The first system is the most important system to determine the performance of the whole system. The most important system is the first one. Very important. Why? Because you can see the composite temperature equal to TE1 directly. Okay. During that design, usually they have what is known low noise amplifier. Low noise amplifier. You can invest a lot of money in the first system. Then you can get high performance.
But what is now the importance of the cascaded system then? Mm-hmm. What is the importance of the cascaded system?
Yes, because for example, let's say that we have satellite system. So we have this antenna. You have the first amplifier to amplify the antenna. Then you have frequency conversion. Then you have the coaxial line. Then you have the receiver. Inside the receiver, you have another amplifier, and so on. Until you have the TV plug to your TV that you are watching. Okay, so during this process, okay, you can go that starting from this amplifier, if you design this amplifier in bad way, or you use that amplifier, the whole system will not work. Whatever you invest here, because you lost the test. Let us take this example. If you design a system which has TE1, let's say equal to, for example, 50 Kelvin, okay, and this one, you don't care about the cascaded system. So for this one, it was, let's say, 1,000 Kelvin and so on. But you select the first amplifier to be 50 Kelvin with gain equal to, for example, 40 dB. For example. Okay. Now if you want to compute the composite equivalent noise temperature equal to TE1 is 50 plus TE2 is 1,000. It is bad system, but it is divided by 40 dB is 10 of the power 4. So what is the contribution for the system? Only 0.1.
It is negligible.
It is negligible because you designed the first system correctly. And this is the reason that when you see the receiver antenna dish, usually they have LNB. It is called LNB. No noise block. In the low noise block, they have low noise amplifier and they have the down conversion of the frequency. So this low noise amplifier they are designed to have low noise block. This you can read it for every LNB. You can see the noise figure, which is usually given. Like they say, this is 0.6, 0.7. Of course, there are some fake. They say that it is 0.1 or 0.0 or 0 dB. It's impossible, of course. Impossible to have 0 dB. But they say that when you go to the market, oh, you can see I have like 0.01. It is the best, okay? Which is the worst will be. So then you have this is the idea of the cascaded system. It's the whole system, okay? You can also do the same as we did for the noise figure. For the noise figure, because there's a linear relation between the noise figure and the noise equivalent noise temperature. Equivalent noise temperature equals to noise figure minus 1 times T0. And you just substitute here, and you got the noise figure, then you will have, it is the same meaning here. So the noise figure of the composite system is the noise figure for first system, front end system. This is F1. And then the others are divided by the antenna gains. So it is important to remember that for the cascaded communication system, the first system should have very good noise properties and high gain. Then you can control the other parameters. Okay, here we have this example. I'm not interested to give this example because of time, but we go to the second example. In the second example,
antenna design
is given in other technology course. It is different course that we give the more details about transmission line antenna design. Not in this course.
Not in this program.
It is in the program, but it is different course. So maybe next not next year, but in the spring, in the autumn next year. Yes, it will be in autumn 2017. It will be given this RF technology. The course name is RF technology. where we study starting from Maxwell's equations, and then we go through the transmission line and Taylor design and those things.
Okay.
Yes, but the course is also available for book exam. For example, if some students want to have the slides and read by themselves, it is also available. We have already now some exchange students who take the course as a self-study. Self-study, yes. Okay, now we have in this example that the transmitted power of a satellite is 50 watts. The carrier frequency is 12 gigahertz. If the transmission antenna gain is 30 dB, what is the effective isotropic radiation power? Okay, as we said that, remember always to convert from linear scale to dB. Don't mix them. Don't mix them, okay? I repeat always this, but always the same thing. We have the transmitting power is 50 dB, 50 watts. Okay, is it correct? This is 50 watts. Okay. And the antenna gain is equal to what?
30 dB.
30 dB by linear scale is 10 to the power 3. Okay. The effective isotropic radiation power is equal to Vt times 30 equal to 50,000. Okay? What? That's it. You can convert them to DC dB if you want, so it becomes 10 log 50,000. Or you can convert this to dB, but what? And you add dB watt with this antenna gain. So it is the same. Okay. And the second is the satellite distance is at, if the satellite at distance of 35,800 kilometers, and the required receiving power to obtain good reception is 1 big watt. What is the required receiver antenna gain? Okay. Now we have the receiving power. We can use now the free space model. So the receiving power equal to the transmitting power times transmitting antenna gain times receiving antenna gain divided by 4 by d divided by lambda c squared. Lambda is given because the carrying frequency is 12 gigahertz. So lambda equal to 3 times 10 to the power 8 divided by 12 times 10 to the power 9, okay, and this gives 0.025 meters. Then remember to change the distance to meters because the distance here is given in kilometers, so you multiply by 1000 to convert it to meters. In that case, we can compute the antenna gain at the receiver should be. We can multiply this here, so it becomes 4 by d divided by lambda all squared times the received power, the required received power divided by Vt dt. Then we have the received power should be given as 1 big watt. Then we can compute as it is shown in those slides. And finally, we found that the antenna gain, the receiver antenna gain, must be at least or greater than or equal to 6,000. 476, which is equivalent to about 38 dB. Okay, we can also convert from dB to the diameter of the antenna dish because there is a relation of the parabolic antenna, that the parabolic antenna gain or the parabola is equal to the antenna efficiency eta times the diameter of the antenna by times d divided by lambda squared. Sorry, lambda, just lambda and squared is here. Okay? Now you have the antenna gain. And this relation is not in decibel. Now you've got the linear scale. This, you substitute like 6,476 equal to eta times pi d over lambda all squared. Then you can find the diameter of that antenna. You can find the diameter of the antenna required to achieve this, and by solving this, we found that the diameter of this antenna is 0.95 meters. This is the minimum diameter. Because now you can use 1 meter, for example, for this to receive the signal. To achieve what? To achieve this 1 big watt requirement. Because here we said that we need to have the reception to be 1 big watt. Now, we can go in more, like, as you know that we like to make things difficult. And because of that, we never bring in the exam such nice question. Just we give the 1 gigawatt, but we can make it a little bit more mixed. Like what? Like I say that, okay, you use binary phase shifting. Okay, and in the system, and you need the probability of error to be less than or equal to 10 to the power minus 4. Okay, and if I want to be nice enough, then I can give directly the equivalent noise temperature of the system that you have, that the total noise temperature, for example, is equal to, I say that, is equal to, say, 1,000 Kelvin, for example, okay? Then we ask you, what is the uncleanness? Okay, in this case, it is almost the same, but what you need to see? Now, instead of giving that, what is the required reception power, now we give it another link you need to compute. We have the binary shift keying, then we have that, we know that what should be the bit error rate, how to compute it. So the bit error rate
is Q.
Bd equal to Q of square root 2EB divided by N0. Okay, what is N0? Today we talk it. It is K T total, the equivalent noise temperature. T is given, K is constant, Be required is known, is 10 to the power minus 4. What we can calculate? We can calculate EB. Okay, EB from this equation, the required EB could be computed now because we have everything except EB. So assume that EB is equal to that 10 to the power minus 9 joule, for example. We know that EB is equal to the receiving power times
the same.
T is the symbol duration. Okay, now if it was given here, that I said that the data rate is equal to 10 megabit per second, it is easy. T is 0.1 times 10 to the power minus 6. We have this one, is equal to, for example, 10 to the power minus 9. Then we can compute what is the required BR. And now you come to the same example. Now it is, you compute what is the, here the reception power is just given. Now the reception power you need to find. But you need to add one step. The step is, what is the modulation, the technique used. You build, you know the relation, the equation. You know what is given. Then you can compute EB. And it can be also given different way. We can say, for example, that because with this equation, now we can compute the antenna gain. But if the antenna gain was given already, and then the question was, what is the maximum data rate you can achieve if you use binary phase shifting? Now the antenna gain was given. Okay, since the antenna gain was given, so the power received equal to what? Equal to transmitting power given, antenna gain given, receiver antenna gain, it is given now, divided by 4 by d is given, distance, divided by lambda is given, c squared. We can compute the receiving power. Okay, now we compute the receiving power. Now we know everything. What is that? Because the receiving power is given now. EB is calculated. What is the missing point? Is T. We compute D, then 1 over T is the maximum data rate we can send over this satellite link to achieve 10 to the power minus 4.
Okay? Please come again.
Yeah.
I got lost in the last statement.
What?
The last statement.
From here.
Yes.
Is it clear up to now?
Yes.
Okay. Now, okay. Let us put it in a different way. Okay, I will just speak now. What is the bit rate that I should use? Yes, because of, do you know?
0.0000.
Because now it means that the symbol error rate is very high in your your brains, because the simple rate is high, so I need to reduce my rate in order to increase the energy per second. Okay, now let me do it in more in different way. So, because instead of repeating the same example, I will repeat it but slightly different. Now, instead of finding the shift being, let's say that it's given 8 array. Phase shift king, okay? Everything was given in the example. We give the transmitter power, the distance, the carry frequency, everything, the antenna gain for the transmitter, antenna gain for the receiver, okay? And. We call you, we said that we use binary, phase shift king MRA, okay? And also I give the bandwidth. I give the bandwidth. So the bandwidth of the system is 1 megahertz. I give the bandwidth 1 megahertz. Okay? And I want requirement, the simple rate, to be less than 10 of the power, let's say, minus 3. Okay? And I gave also the T total temperature, 1000 Kelvin. And now we don't have the data rate. And now I ask you, what is the maximum bit rate you can achieve in this system? I can repeat, maybe it is good to write this example here. Okay. You have an example of satellite receiver, okay, with TX transmission power. Equal to 50 watts. This is the same as the example. Okay, distance is 38,500 kilometers. Okay, the antenna gain, transmitter antenna gain is 30 dB. The receiver antenna gain is also 35 dB. Okay, and the total temperature, the total noise temperature is equal to 1,000 Kelvin. Okay. And the bandwidth of the system is equal to 1 megahertz. Okay? And the requirement, simple rate, the probability of simple rate, that's simple error rate, should be less than equal to 10 to the power minus 3. Okay? What is the maximum? The maximum bit rate you can achieve, or it can be also given different. That what is the spectral efficiency? It is the same meaning. The spectral efficiency, because the spectral efficiency is bit per second bit hertz. You have already 1 megahertz. So the spectral efficiency, if you can send 3 bits per hertz, means that you can send that rate of 3 megabit per second. So it is the same meaning. It can be given in a different way, like what is the maximum bit rate you can achieve, or what is the maximum spectral efficiency you can achieve in this satellite link. Not necessarily satellite, of course, in the exam, it can be changed. For example, we say that you have macro cell, you have base station. It is the same. I mean, whatever. Here, it is satellite, then we use the free space model. Mm-hmm. But we can use, for the macro cell, we can use another model for D of the power 4. But usually I inform you what model that you use. Mm-hmm. If nothing about the channel model, usually you can use the free space. Okay? Is the problem clear or not? The problem before the solution.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, let us go. Actually, this such kind of problems are one of the easiest problems in the exam, but at the same time, the one which the students confuse you. Yes, because when they start
about five lines,
yes, a lot of information, yeah, they confuse. Yes, but now when you look to this, you can think like top down or the reverse. Okay? Now you start from the requirement, usually this problem. You start from what is the requirement? The requirement here is the maximum bit rate. Okay, maximum bit rate for what modulation? They say that it is M array. It was not given, but it is M array phase shift key. It was given. M array phase shift key. Okay, simply, we come to the M array phase shift key. The probability of error, simple error, equal to 2q of square root 2es divided by n0 times sine by divided by n. This is for generally M array system. Okay, first thing that you just bought this equation in front of you. Okay, look now. This given, because this is the requirement, the probability of simple error that we want 10 of the power minus 3. This one was given, okay? And n0 is given. It is given. Because here we say that the total noise temperature is 1000 Kelvin, and we know that n0 equals to k times 1000. So this also given. Okay. About ES, the energy bit symbol is also given. We not given, but we can compute because they give us that this ES is equal to what? Simply the power received times the time bit symbol, the time duration bit symbol. Where is the time duration bit symbol? It's related to the bandwidth because the bandwidth is 1 megahertz. It means that the maximum symbol rate you can send is 1 mega symbol per second. It is the bandwidth is, yes, it is 1 mega. So it is the symbol time is 1 microsecond. So this one is 1 microsecond was given, but BR is missing now. BR, the symbol power is missing. Okay, BR equal to transmitting power times channel gain times the receiver channel gain 4 by d divided by lambda all squared. So this is what we can do. Every one of those are given. Then we compute receiving power. So this is the receiving power. We have it. We have now TS, as he said, because the bandwidth, the symbol rate, we have it. It is given.
One.
Yes. Now we compute ES. Once we compute ES, we have here ES. We have everything. What is the missing now? M. M is the only missing parameters. For example, if M was, when we solve this problem, was, let's say, 17, then we can say that we can have 16 array. Usually we take the lower, not the upper. 16 array, phase 15. And what is the bit rate now? Because we have 1 megahertz band, 1 times 4. Over this microwave link or over this satellite link, we can have 4 megabit per second. Is it difficult? All of them, of course, it can be matrix also. For example, for the here we give in total time. But what if instead of giving you the total time here, we gave that you have no noise amplifier with TE equal to, let's say, 10 of 100, then you have a cable with losses equal to, let's say, 10 dB. Then you have amplifier with like gain equal to 20 dB, but noise figure equal to 20 dB. Okay, and now what you need to compute T total. T total equal to what? Equal to T0 plus T0 is the for the GL, plus TE1
over G1,
plus TE2 for the cable divided by the channel gain, and so on. Then you can compute that total noise temperature. Here it was given directly, but here you might need to compute it. The most important advice for such kind of problems, that you start by what is the requirement. What is the requirement from you? You bought the equation, then start to look what is missing, what is given. Okay? Don't confuse, because when they say, as you said, because there's a lot of things given, like we say that satellite receiver with transmission power 50 watts, the distance given, then transmitting antenna gain, receiver antenna gain, then we start to give the noise figure of the receiver, the noise figure of the cable, the noise figure. You might get such confused a lot of things. How to what links together? And finally, the solution is three lines. Just when you got the equation, that was the requirement, then what are the missing? Then the missing you try to find from the given in the problem, from the text. Okay, in zero is missing. Okay, in zero is what? Is k times t. Where is t? T is not given, but they give a system. Okay, I need now to compute t. I compute t. Okay, now done. What else? ES is not given, but I can calculate this because ES is the cubic power times the simple time. Then the cubic power, I can calculate it because it is, I know the relation. It was given, the transmitting was given everything, so then I calculate it. It will be six in this way. Actually, you can see here, we have about six or seven examples, solved examples. Okay, we try to do with them. Try to go with them example by example. Next lecture, on Monday, of course, we will start talking about coding. But if you have any problems that you face, and you cannot understand, even you discuss together about those examples, bring them to in Monday. So we will solve them together.
So what's the relationship between the TS and the bandwidth? I always get those confused.
Yes. Usually, this is the simple duration time. Okay, the symbol, not the bit.
Not the byte.
Okay, if it is binary specific king, the symbol is the same as the bit. But simple time is means that regardless of the modulation, what are the transmitting symbols? Okay, usually in phase shift king, the one divided by the symbol duration is the same as the bandwidth. The bandwidth can be approximated as one divided by TS. If you remember, when we talk about Nyquist criterion, we said that the bandwidth is 1 divided by 2t. Yeah? But that one was not modulated. It was in the baseband. But when it is modulated, it means that we need double the band. When we modulate any signal, for example, if you have this in the baseband, you have this signal B. When you multiply by cosine, what happened? You shift all this signal to the current frequency. Now, the signal becomes, what is the band now of this signal? 2B. Any modulated signal, unless it is single side band. But generally, when you multiply any signal by cosine, the bandwidth will be duplicated. Okay, and this is the reason that now we need 1 over TS, not 1 over 2 TS. Okay, yes, please.
I thought the modulated signal occupies less bandwidth.
Sorry?
The modulated signal occupies less bandwidth.
This bandwidth. Of course, if we can reduce the bandwidth, we should do that. But now, for example, in the binary phase shift keying, it needs double. It is double sideband. There are some techniques like single sideband techniques, but it is more complicated. Than that. Yes.
What if I modulate the baseband signal
with FM in the frequency modulation, for example? In that case, the band would be larger. The band, it would be as if you remember that the band would be related to 1 plus some eta times the band of the system itself. So, and this can be more than 1, like 2, 3, the bandwidth. For general, we are not talking about digital case. In digital case, the band will be the same as double. Digital case, because you have, when you have changes between 1 and 0, like binary case, what will be the worst case? What is the worst case? If you have like plus or minus one, and they are by random signal, okay. In terms of band, the worst case, if you have a transition from 1 to -1 for every time bit, this would be the worst. If you have like this one. So this would be the worst, it would take the highest band. Okay, in that case, what will be the structure of this square wave? It will be sync, discrete sync. Okay, and usually in digital communication, we can take that sync, okay, as double the frequency of this band. So this is the minimum band that we can recover the transmitted symbols. But in analog case, when you have analog signal, then we need higher band in order to preserve, because actually the real bandwidth of FSL for frequency modulation or the theoretical band is infinity. If you remember, when we talk about this business functions, about the, you, have you attended this electronic communication?
Yeah.
Yes. So we have this business functions, and based on that, we can see that the band can be infinity in analog case. But 98% of the band is located within the...
Sorry, it's sampled analog signal, it's sampled it.
Yes, yes. If it is sampled, like because now if the signal is sampled, we have like discrete but analog. Okay, so it will be the same. Because actually the band is related to the distribution, probability distribution of the signal itself, or the distribution of the signal itself. So, but the band will be always infinity in the FSK.
So the occupied bandwidth of the modulated signal will be less or more than the before modulation.
Yeah, for the frequency modulation, the bandwidth required will be greater than or equal to the double of the bandwidth of the signal, the baseband signal. As a minimum, is too big. What do you mean by that?
The power to be transmitted signal.
Now, when you talk about the power, then we think about the signal ratio at those. Okay.
Other than an ideal case.
In the ideal case, yes, we increase the power, then the signal translation will be increased at the receiver. But the band, what band we select, it will affect mainly the distortion of the signal. If we cut the band more than the whole band of the signal, then we have distortion. This distortion cannot be like substituted by increasing the power. Okay?
By the way, sir.